All right, so in sixth grade, I began my research for science fair with a relatively simple project. If I change the design of an SS model rocket in different ways, which design will fly the highest? Now, I had predicted that the rocket with no modifications would go the highest, but in fact, this hypothesis was wrong in one case. The rocket that I had added tape to sticking all over ended up flying the highest, even though I had predicted that the tape would add drag, therefore the rocket would not fly as high. So I had to do some research as to why this might have happened, and I decided that maybe the tape had acted as vortex generators. Now, vortex generators are, they sound more complicated than they really are. They're just these little blades, I guess you could call them, that are used on generally smaller airplanes to reduce the drag and add lift at a slow speed in order to reduce stall speed. Now, what a stall is, it's when the wing of an airplane gets at a very high angle to the air coming at it, and the air comes over and separates off the end of the wing, as you can see in the picture on the left. And now the wing can no longer create lift. But with vortex generators, the air comes over the wing and adheres to the wing, so the wing continues to create lift. So seventh grade was the blood and bones of my project. I was privileged to work with a mentor named Adrian Adamson that year, who he worked on the Spirit and Opportunity Mars rovers. And, you know, he's obviously, as you can tell, really smart. In his spare time, he actually made these altimeters right here. And they're for model rockets, and they measure altitude and speed, among other things. So I remember the first time he came over to my house to explain how to use his altimeters. We're sitting at my dining room table, and he's explaining how to use his altimeter, and he's pointing to this computer, and he's explaining all these complex equations, and I just have no idea what he's talking about. And you know that feeling you get when you so much don't know what somebody's talking about, where you can't even ask questions about it? That's the feeling I got. So after he left, my mom came up to me and said, "Well, what did he tell you about the altimeter? What did he tell you about the altimeter?" And I just said, I pretty much nodded and smiled my way through it, and I wrote down these random words I heard here and there, but other than that, I didn't know what he was talking about. But undeterred by his superior intelligence, I took the few ideas that I had written down and did some research and actually did some Q&A back and forth with Adrian. And I came up with a plan for my seventh grade science project. The plan was to do 24 launches to prove that vortex generators reduce drag on model rockets. The plan didn't go exactly as intended. So I launched out at my cousin's ranch in the winter, in the snow, and it was cold. So, and on top of all that, it was windy. So this pretty much meant that the rockets never landed within the ranch's property. So there's a lot of running and jumping of fences and avoiding barbed wire. And that, look, that great hairdo I got there. That not only sacrificed my sanity, but also my genes. So also the rockets never lasted maybe more than 6 launches without needing a repair. So there I was, torn pants and all, running after these rockets like a deranged dog running after tennis balls. There's snow in my boots, and I'm trying to make these repairs really quick and easy in my car, and it smells like sulfur and glue. And then I'm running all the way back out into the middle of the field to enter in this data from my altimeter into this computer with frozen hands. Unfortunately, instead of 24 times repeating this, I had to repeat it 43 times. This is because about halfway through, I realized that the data I was getting was not accurate. So I had to do 19 more launches in order to make it accurate. That was not fun. So near the end, I was in tears because my shock cord had broke and the altimeter had plummeted to the ground for like the 1,000th time, and the wires had popped out, and it was cold, and I was hungry, and it was late. I just wanted to be done. But I kept testing for the glory of discovery. In eighth grade, I was given the fantastic opportunity to work in the wind tunnel at CU Denver with the assistance of Professor Joe Cullen. The really cool thing, if you think about it, of using a wind tunnel is that, you know, the Wright brothers, all the way back when they invented the first powered airplane, used wind tunnels to test their designs. Now NASA uses wind tunnels to test their designs, and now I got to use a wind tunnel to test my design. And so when I first arrived at the wind tunnel and met Professor Cullen, it was that same feeling when I met Adrian. And, you know, he's explaining all this equipment and this data I would be getting and all these words that I did not understand. And, you know, all I was hearing was, you know, Charlie Brown's mom or teacher, whoever it is, going wah, 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 wah. So, but eventually, because Mr. Cullen was very good at explaining these concepts, eventually I figured out the ways of the wind tunnel. And the nice thing about using the wind tunnel was that I was able to control variables such as wind and the tilting of the rocket that I was not able to control the year before when launching the rockets. So even though everything was going great in the wind tunnel, there's always a point in an experiment where everything just comes to a screeching halt. This happened for me when I realized that the data this year was conflicting with the data the year before. The vortex generators in the wind tunnel, it was showing that the vortex generators were adding drag at every position and every speed, which I did not want. While the year before, the vortex generators had consistently reduced drag at a low speed. So I had to find out, why are these results conflicting? Where had I gone wrong? And at that moment, my future flashed before my eyes. And I knew that if I did not solve this problem, I would be doomed to a life of failure, and my dreams of becoming an aerospace engineer were just dashed. But coming back to reality, Professor Cullen came to my aid, and we went through some extensive brainstorming about what might be the issue, and we came up with an idea that maybe the very things that we were trying to control with the wind tunnel, such as the wind and the tilting of the rocket, were the things that allowed the vortex generators to reduce the drag in the first place. So to simulate this idea, I mounted the rocket at an angle in the wind tunnel, so you can see that here. So these tests proved very successful, because the vortex generators consistently reduced drag at when the rocket was at an angle. So now I made this mechanism here. There's me in my incredibly messy shed. I made this mechanism here that extends the vortex generators when they reduce drag, and they're in while they add drag. So pretty much all I have this radio-controlled airplane controller, and I flip this switch, and it sends a signal to this servo. You can tell it's actually pretty simple. It sends a signal to this servo in here, and that servo pushes down on this, which is pretty flimsy, but it's a prototype. And it's got vortex generators on the end, pushes down on this cone in here, and the vortex generators push down and out on that cone and out of the rocket. So let's see. After these 3 years of hard work on these science fair projects, I was able to have some pretty amazing opportunities. After a long application process, I was chosen among 29 other 7th, 8th, and 9th graders to participate in this Broadcom Masters competition. And it was great because I met and worked with kids that had the same interests as me in the STEM category, which is science, technology, engineering, and math. And we met the president, and he's really tall, and we got a minor planet named after us, which is pretty cool too. Okay, and now here I am doing a TEDx talk, and it all started with science fair and an idea. So now let's move ahead in time. How can what I've learned be applied in the future? Well, NASA and other private companies are breaking new ground in developing spaceflight technologies, not only for exploration, but also for flight around the globe, commercial spaceflight. Vortex generators may be able to be applied to these new rocket designs in order to reduce the drag while the rocket is in the atmosphere. SpaceX is a company that's in the aerospace industry, and they've developed this rocket called the Grasshopper. And what the Grasshopper can do, which is very cool, it launches from one spot, and then it can launch, maneuver, even hover, then it comes back down and it can land in that same spot upright. Unlike a space shuttle, which launches and lands like an airplane. So Colorado has been and will continue to be a very important part of the aerospace industry. We have CU, which is has a nationally recognized aerospace program, Lockheed Martin, United Launch Alliance, and Sierra Nevada, who is working on the Dream Chaser, which could possibly be NASA's next space vehicle. One more cool thing about Colorado, we have Front Range Airport, which soon may very well be Front Range Spaceport for spaceflight transportation. So imagine yourself, instead of climbing into an airplane for a trip from New York to London that would take 8 hours, you're climbing into a rocket to blast into low Earth orbit at 17,500 miles per hour for a trip of an hour and a half instead. Or even imagine yourself being one of the first people to step onto an asteroid or even Mars. As a kid, you're at the perfect age to accomplish this goal of being an astronaut. So, but there are these barriers, unfortunately, that will have to be passed in order for all of this to be possible. One is expense, two is fuel and propulsion, and three is efficiency. Now, researchers and scientists are all working on these issues, but young, fresh minds are really necessary to come up with these ideas that nobody's come up with before. All it takes is just to have a little bit of drive, passion, motivation, just interest in the things around you. Ask your counselor or teacher about getting a mentor like I did, and new opportunities will open themselves up to you. Just experiment with the things around you also. There's so much more to be explored and to discover. The universe is immense, you can see here, and expanding. This is a real photo. Each of those lights is a galaxy, and each galaxy has hundreds of billions of stars, and each star has a solar system, and each solar system has planets, and we are just one planet in one solar system. That just tells you how vast the universe is and how much more there is to be explored. So exploration and discovery should be part of life. Make them a part of yours. Thank you.